Allahu Akbar.
Thank you for joining ICNA's webinar, remembering Bosnia 25 years after as we commemorate and remember the horrific genocide in Srebrenica in 1992.
Before he continued, Kadir wanted to express his appreciation and thanks to a publisher of his book, Behar Publishing, and he asked for people to try to get the book and read about it. And then he says what he remembers out of these 17 days of ordeal of trying to survive, first being injured in, you know, shot in a leg, and then also with his hands tied behind his back, which he eventually managed to free, and then also, you know, being hungry and scared. He says one day he actually exhausted, he fell asleep, and he had a dream in which he felt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that he should return to Islam and he should spend the rest of his life reading Quran and reminding others about reading Quran. And he said that dream gave him so much strength and so much power to actually survive. He says after that he knew he would survive, and it was a great a boost for his morale and energy, and that's what led him eventually to survive everything and reach the free territory, and nowadays to talk to us about it. Kaži nam, Kadire, prije nego što otvorimo prostor za pitanja i odgovore, jer ljudi koji nas gledaju možda imaju pitanja, htjeli bi da pitamo i tebe kao i sestru Feridu. Šta za tebe znači ovaj juli, 11. juli koji mi obilježavamo? Šta znači za ljude koji su preživjeli Srebrenicu, kao što si ti ili kao što je sestra Ferida, i šta bi ti volio da svi ljudi koji nas danas slušaju i gledaju znaju i pamte?
11. juli, to je jedan datum koji moramo nositi i pamtiti dugo i dugo dokle postojimo. To je jedan datum u kojem su ljudi
And I am a professor of political science from Florida, and I will assist us today in this conversation. So I will try to be as a host, speak in both languages, and then Sister Ferida will speak in Bosnian, and Sister Lena, she is the Secretary General of the Institute for Genocide Institute in Canada, right? She would be
Institute for the Research of Genocide in Canada.
Institute for the Research of Genocide in Canada. She will be translating from English to Bosnian and from Bosnian to English. And so the first question that we would like to ask Sister Ferida today, when we mark 25 years after genocide, we would like to remember our loved ones and who were there, who were murdered then. So in that way, we would like to humanize these victims, because oftentimes we speak of numbers, but we don't speak of individual people who lost their lives. So Sister Ferida, please tell us how many family members you lost, who were they, and do you know how and where they were murdered?
Teta Ferida, mi želimo da čujemo vašu priču i htjeli bi da nam vi kažete o vašoj situaciji, kako ste vi prošli u Srebrenici, koga ste izgubili i da ih se sjetimo sad.
U Srebrenica izgubila bliže rodbine 30 osoba, znači to je bliža onaj rodbina moja koja je, jedni su poginuli padom Srebrenice, jedni su u toku rata, znači to su brat, otac, muž, svekar, moji amiđići, dajđići, tetići, tetka jedna od 75 godina. Bilo ih je...
Ja ću sad samo da vas malo prekinem i da prevedem da bi oni mogli da razumijem. Oprostite, molim vas. My name is Ferida, I'm from Srebrenica. I lost about close to 30 members of my close family, including my brother, my father, husband, my father-in-law, my first cousins, and my second cousins, my aunt. Either they were killed or they lost their lives during the war in Bosnia. Izvolite.
Gospođo Ferida, jel se sjećate ili znate kako i gdje su oni ubijeni?
Do you remember where how they died and how you know if you guys had found them? I'm trying to. Izvolite.
Većina njih je otišla padom Srebrenice preko šume. Jedni su.
Most of them have died walking through the forest, trying to reach the freedom. Izvolite.
Drugi su u toku agresije na Bosnu i Hercegovinu i na poginuli na linijama i toku na tim granatiranje i tu.
Some of them also have died during the aggression that was done upon the Bosnia Herzegovina.
Samo muž je bio u potačarima jer su njegova dva brata otišla preko šume sa vojskom prema Tuzli, a muž je došao u potačar u UN-ovu bazu i tu su ga agresori koji su izvršili genocid nad našim narodom, oni su ga odvojili i od moje jetrve i sakra.
My husband came to the UN safe place of Potocari and stayed there, and he was actually taken from us and by the aggressors, whereas his two other brothers went walking through the forest trying to reach the freedom.
Okay, one thing that we should probably mention so that people who are watching understand the context. Srebrenica was declared a United Nations safe zone, and it was to be protected by United Nations until July of 1995, when it was overrun by Serbian forces. And, United Nations failed to carry the responsibility to protect people, especially Holland soldiers from Holland that were in charge. And so when what Sister Ferida is talking about, she's actually describing, that she lost the members of her family throughout that siege, which lasted for over 2 years. So we have to remember the Srebrenica genocide came at the end of that siege. So the Bosnian Muslims were surrounded in that town, and they were promised to be protected by United Nations. But then finally, at the end of the war, the Serbs took the city because the city was defenseless, not protected by United Nations as promised. And then they start separating men and women. And this is where most of Sister Ferida's male members of her family were taken or killed in one way or the other. Some of the Muslim men tried to escape by walking through the enemy lines, and some of them thought that United Nations will protect them, and they stayed in the base, in the UN base. And so what we are asking Sister to describe, how did she lose her members in particular? You don't have to translate this, Lena. So, Sestro Ferida, kaži nam, jel su pronađena tijela vaših ubijenih i jeste li ih uspjeli ukopati u potočarima kao i ostalo? Do you know where the bodies of your loved ones are, and were you able to bury them in portrayed next to Srebrenica?
Oni su od 2008. Su počeli pronalaziti i obaveštavati nas od ove uže i bliže rodbine, pa do 2014.
From 2008 to 2014, they were discovering the bodies and notifying us.
Ukopani su, međutim, nijedno nije kompletno tijelo, znači od svih tih ukopanih, znači tu su kosti od noge, od ruke, ili uglavnom nijedno tijelo nije bilo kompletno.
So the bodies that they did discover were not completed. There were some of the bones only, but we did bury them. Just to remind you again, the bodies were not completed. They were found bone by bone, and whichever they belonged to, we buried them.
Walt. Kažite nam, pošto, again, to just to add the context, the remains of the people killed in Srebrenica are still to be found in multiple mass graves. And sometimes remains of one person will be found in more than three mass graves. That shows that those who committed genocide later on tried to hide their crimes by reburying those dead and hiding them in the mass graves, and they're still being found. Kaže nam sestru Ferida nešto o svom mužu. Mi bi htjeli da vidimo kakav je on čovjek bio, šta je radio. Kako ste se rastali kad su vas razdvojili u Srebrenici? Šta vi pamtite o njemu kao čovjeku? Can you please tell us, Sister Ferida, about your husband? What kind of man was he? What was he doing? And do you remember what did he say when they separated you in Srebrenica in July 1995?
Moj muž Zahid Delić je bio izuzetno dobra osoba i pozitivna, nije nikome mislio zlo, znači svakome je želio dobro. Do prije rata je radio u Ferosu, u Potočarima.
My husband Zahid Delić was a very great man. He was a kind, peaceful, never meant anything bad to anybody. He worked in Feros, in Potočar, in Srebrenica.
U toku rata je bio pri vojsci, pošto je imao isto dva brata koja su bila u vojsci, tako je i on bio. A posljednji naš rastanak je bio u Potočarima, koji će mi znači ostati u sjećanju dok god sam živa. Znači, ja sam bila u 7. mjesecu trudnoće tada.
So during the aggression, my husband joined the army, as did his two brothers. Our last goodbyes were said in Potočari. At that time, I was seven months pregnant. Izvolite.
Znači je ostao i znači kad su ga odvojili, agresorska vojska kad su ga odvojila, ja sam samo uspjela pogledati u njega i on u meni, i on je meni očima rekao da ja idem da sebe spašavam i dijete.
When we were saying our goodbyes, they separated him into the aggressor Serbian army separated him and took him. We kind of look at each other, and from his looks I could see that he was telling me last goodbye and saying go on and take care of our child.
Znači, on nije upo, rodila sam sina nakon dva mjeseca, znači u septembru rodila sam sina koji nije zapamtio svog oca.
2 months later I had a baby boy, but he never remembered his dad.
Tako da, kad smo se upoznali, taj trenutak ću pamtiti, znači, dok sam živa, a rastanak još dublji i teže mi je ostao u sjećanju.
I will always remember the first time I saw him and when we fell in love. And then I certainly will remember our last goodbyes.
Znači, još uvijek mi je ta slika našeg rastanka u Potočarima I svaki put kad odem tamo imam osjećaj da ću, da ću ga vidjeti tu opet, takav je osjećaj, ali nažalost kad se vraćam, tužan je to trenutak.
So every time I go to Potočari and visit the graves, I still have that feeling that I might be able to see him because, you know, of the circumstances that happened. And I'm kind of looking forward to it, knowing that when I leave, that gut feeling that I have, that that will never happen again. And it's not a good feeling.
Kaži nam, sestro Ferida, ko su bile ubice? Ko su bili ljudi koji su vas ubijali? Znaš li ti zašto su oni to... Zašto su vas toliko mrzili? Zašto su vas ubijali?
Pa, ubice...
Samo moment. Ask the sister, do you know who were the killers? Who were the people who were killing you? And do you know why they hated you so much?
Ubice I... znači, agresori ti su bili naše prve komšije, znači...
Our murderers were our first neighbors, the ones we knew.
Znači, oni su, to smo na početku vidjeli, da su oni bili s druge strane, da su pucali na nas I granatirali nas.
We could see firsthand that they were our neighbors, the ones who were killing us and shooting at us across the lines.
Dok kasnije nije se pridružila I vojska iz Srbije sa naoružanjem jačim I većim I vojskom.
And later they had a Serbian army, national Serbian army, joining them and helping them with all the atrocities they've done.
A što su nas ubili, ubijali I zašto su pucali na nas, to... Vjerovatno što smo drugačije se zvali, što smo muslimani, druge vjere.
The reason why they were killing us probably is because we were different from them, different religious beliefs. We had a different names.
Zbog čega nas mrze, to... Ne znam, ne mogu objasniti jer ništa im nismo učinili, ništa nismo ničim izazvali početak rata, nego jednostavno oni su tražili, znam na početku, da smo, kad smo išli na teravije, u džamije I vraćamo se sa teravija, da su oni grupisali tako da su naoružavali se I...
Why they were killing us and why were they doing all this to us, it's still unknown. We don't know why they hated us. All we kind of figured and saw was when we were, you know, fasting and going to the mosques and doing Tarawih prayer, coming back home, we could see that they weren't happy with that and they were probably planning all this.
Dobro, sestro, da prije nego što pređemo Kadira, da te pitamo, ovo, svake godine se 11. jula još uvijek ukopavaju ostaci ubijenih ljudi koji se nalaze po tim masovnim grobnicama. Kaži ti, ako možeš da nam kažeš, šta za vas preživjele Srebreničane znači taj 11. juli I šta bi htjela ti da mi svi koji u svijetu sad gledamo, šta bi ti htjela da mi znamo I da mi zapamtimo? So I asked the sister every year on July 11, the remains of people who were killed in 1995 and were being found in some of the mass graves ever since the war ended are still being buried. And so I asked what does July 11 means to the Srebrenica survivors like you, and what would you like us all to know and to remember?
Svaki početak godine mi se pripremamo za 11. jul, odnosno za od 1. do 11. jula.
Every year, at the beginning of the year, which we prepare for the July, and we start, our preparations begin right at the beginning of a year for the week of from July 1st to July 11th.
Kad se završi dženaza, znači mi se onda ponovo moramo da oporavljamo I da dolazimo sebi, da bi ponovo opet svaki početak godine dočekali opet 11. juli, tako da nam je svaka I svaki 11. skoro pa isto.
So every year we basically go the same, Mirsad as well, Buyurun Mako, malo sam se zbunila ovdje.
Every year we get ready to remember, and then every new year we are again getting ready to remember and with overwhelmed by feelings.
Yeah, constantly reminded, being reminded of the atrocities done upon us and our people. So every year we'll begin and plan for July 11th, but after the janaza prayer, we still go through the same stress and go through the same feelings of, you know, what happened to us. And then we start all over again. Izvolite.
Moja poruka je da se nikada I nikome ne dogodi takvo zlo, a da se što više prenosi na mlade I na omladinu I na našu djecu. Što sad ove godine je to slučaj, pogotovo što je ovako stanje korone u čitavom svijetu, više je se omladine uključilo ovako preko ovih društvenih mreža.
My message to all of you and to everybody who listens to us is that please try to remember Srebrenica, try to spread the message of the genocide that happened, especially within the younger generations. We need to spread the word and make sure that this never happens again.
And sister also said that since we are now in the corona kind of semi-isolation, she says this year has been done through this social media, and she thinks it's good that we are doing it. But now we can move on, and we can have a short conversation with our second guest, with our brother Kadir Habibović. Kadir Habibović is one of the few men who survived one of those mass killings in July 1995. He survived by untying his hand, jumping off the truck, and then jumping off the truck that was taking him to be killed, and then running away, hiding, and eventually arriving to the free territory. I described his ordeal in a book. He wrote a book titled "Life Against Death." Life Against Death, Srebrenica, that is going to be published this July in English language for the first time. And if anyone is interested, you can contact our ICNA and we will provide you with information, more information about the book. Eventually left Bosnia. He now lives in Western Europe where he's trying to cope with the horrors that he survived. But every July 11, Kadir goes back to Srebrenica with his family to revisit those sites where he was tortured and where he escaped the death. He was there today also, and he just returned from the site. He just joined us after he came back. So we will have a conversation with him about his feelings and about a particular incident, particular, how you say, part of his story of survival. So, Kadir, you were in Srebrenica today. What do you think when you go there? What were your thoughts today when you were there? Is there anything that you have that you feel or you think about every year when you go to Srebrenica? Kadire, danas si bio u Srebrenici, kao I svake godine. Mi smo opisali da si ti svoje iskustvo napisao u knjizi I rekli smo da si, otprilike, kako si preživio to streljanje, si jedan od rijetkih muškaraca, da sada živiš koji su preživjeli, da sada živiš u zapadnoj Evropi, ali da svake godine odeš u Srebrenicu, pa smo pitali danas kad si bio, čemu si razmišljao dok si bio tamo I imali neka misao ili osjećaj koji ti se javlja u julu kad si u Srebrenici, da se nastavimo na ovo što je sestra Ferida rekla.
Hvala vam pre svega puno da ste mi dali mogućnost da uzmem učešće u ovoj emisiji. Želim sve toplo da poselam. Da, bio sam u Srebrenici danas i tamo čovjek kada dolazi javljaju se uvijek ista tužna sjećanja. Sjećanja na ljude koji su poginuli ni za što krivi u jednom genocidu koji se dogodio samo iz velike mržnje. Mržnje prema narodu koji nije bio iste religije. Sve drugo je bilo isto, samo religija nije bila ista, vjeroispovijest.
Okay,
dakle, ljudi koji su se zvali bošnjačkom vjeroispovješću, bili su ubijani i bacani u masovne grobnice. Poslije su tamo pronalaženi i sahranjeni u veliki memorialni centar koji se nalazi u Podčanu.
Kadir first greeted everybody with salam, and he said that he appreciates that we invited him to share with us his experience. He said every year when he goes there in July, he says he has the same feeling, same thoughts of sorrow. He says that this is that this reminds him about this genocide that was done upon Bosnian Muslims who were innocent. And their only guilt was that they were basically Muslims. And he says the remains of these people who were murdered in July of 1995 and throughout were still being found in some of the mass graves where they were being put after the murder. And these remains were still being found and buried during July of every year, so far for 25 years later. Kaži nam, Kadire, kad ti ideš svake godine u Srebrenicu, zašto? Neki bi možda htjeli da zaborave to što se u Srebrenici desilo, a zašto ti nećeš da zaboraviš i zašto misliš da je važno da svi mi ne zaboravimo? So the question is, why do you go to July, in July to Srebrenica every year and you know, some may want to forget about it, but you don't want to forget. Why?
Da, da Mirso, to je jedno jako i veoma dobro pitanje. Ja sam jedan čovjek koji se bori protiv nezaborava. Za mene je veoma važno sve to ne zaboraviti. Ja vjerujem da postoje ljudi koji isto tako rade kao što ja radim. Ja sam napisao nekoliko knjiga, tri knjige sam napisao posvećene Srebrenici. Prva knjiga je Život protiv smrti i opisujem kako sam ja preživio streljanje vezanih ruku. I ja sigurno nikada to neću moći zaboraviti do kraja života.
Yes, this is for me very important. I actually actively try and fight against those who want to forget. I want to remember, and I want the whole world to remember. And that's why I actually wrote three books about Srebrenica. And the first one was A Life Against Death, and where I describe how I survived one of mass killings while my hands were tied behind my back. Pošto o tome pričaš, Kadire, možeš li nam ispričati dio te priče, kako si preživio streljanje i šta ti je dalo snage da izdržiš bol i strah i glad i da se na kraju domogneš slobodne teritorije pod kontrolom armije Bosne i Hercegovine. So now I'm asking him, can you please describe to us at least part of your story of survival? How did you survive and what gave you strength to overcome pain, fear and hunger and make it to the free territory?
Prije nego što odgovorim na to pitanje, želim da se zahvalim izdavačkoj kući Behar Publishing u Americi, koja ovih dana ima namjeru da izda knjigu na engleskom jeziku I svi oni koji žele da pročitaju knjigu mogu je i naručiti preko ove izdavačke kuće. Tvoje pitanje je bilo, Mirso, zašto? Na koji način, jedan dio ja koji mogu izdvojiti iz onih 17 dana u mojoj borbi da dođem do slobodne teritorije, ja se mogu posvetiti dijelu koji je me u stvari osvijestio i uputio na pravi put. To je u stvari bio jedan san gdje ja sanjam da moram da se vratim vjeri, odnosno učenju Kur'ana. U tome jednom kraćem snu ja dobijam jednu jaku pozitivnu energiju koja me usmjerava, daje mi snagu i ja uspijevam da izdržim do slobodne teritorije.
Before he continued, Kadir wanted to express his appreciation and thanks to a publisher of his book, Behar Publishing, and he asked for people to try to get the book and read about it. And then he says what he remembers out of this 17 days of ordeal of trying to survive, first being injured in, you know, shot in a leg, and then also with his hands tied behind his back, which he eventually managed to free, and then also, you know, being hungry and scared. He says one day he actually exhausted, he fell asleep, and he had a dream in which he felt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that he should return to Islam and he should spend the rest of his life reading Quran and reminding others about reading Quran. And he said that dream gave him so much strength and so much power to actually survive. He says after that he knew he would survive, and it was a great a boost for his morale and energy, and that's what led him eventually to survive everything and reach the free territory, and nowadays to talk to us about it. Kaži nam, Kadire, prije nego što otvorimo prostor za pitanja i odgovore, jer ljudi koji nas gledaju možda imaju pitanja, htjeli bi da pitamo i tebe kao i sestru Feridu. Šta za tebe znači ovaj juli, 11. juli koji mi obilježavamo? Šta znači za ljude koji su preživjeli Srebrenicu, kao što si ti ili kao što je sestra Ferida, i šta bi ti volio da svi ljudi koji nas danas slušaju i gledaju znaju i pamte?
11. juli, to je jedan datum koji moramo nositi i pamtiti dugo i dugo dokle postojimo. To je jedan datum u kojem su ljudi ubijani tako bezdužno, nisu bili ni za šta krivi, ubijani su jednostavno iz mržnje prema njima, i mi taj datum moramo obilježavati i sjećati se tih naših nedužnih ljudi, kada samo znademo da je tamo bilo veliki broj i djece i žena, pored staraca koji su isto tako ubijeni, onda jednostavno mi moramo da taj dan i činimo sve da nikada to nigdje se ne ponovi i da taj datum nikada ne zaboravi.
Well, Kadir says that we have to remember that day, or we use this day to commemorate and remember what happened in Srebrenica, when many, many innocent people were killed simply because of who they were. He says, remember, there were a lot of children who were murdered there. There were a lot of very old and elderly people who were murdered there. And because of all of them, and because of their sacrifice, their victimhood, we have to remember and we have to commemorate this day in July of every year. And he wishes that no one ever forgets, And because if we don't forget, then we will hopefully ensure that it never repeats to anybody again. And I think at this point, we can open up things for questions. We have about, I believe, Brother Waqas, we have about maybe, or rather Dr. Zahid is now going to say something. I'm sorry. Brother Waqas, do you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. I'm sorry. Your voice was a little cutting up. Could you repeat that, please?
I suggest that at this point we open the floor for people who are watching to ask questions, or Dr. Zahid is going to make a comment on about the ICNA's involvement during the war, or what is the next. But I think we can now engage with the people who are watching us live.
Sure, sure. So I'm going over the questions that we have, or the comments that we have received so far. We have received a lot of appreciation for the speakers. You may convey that, a lot of du'as for our guests. You can convey that to them.
Puno ljudi je gleda nas preko tih mreža i puno ljudi se zahvaljuje na vašem učešću danas i zahvaljuje vam se na tome što ste skupili hrabrosti da podijelite sa nama vašu bol i to što osjećate danas.
So these are some of the comments that we have received. I'm just going to read. I think they are also important as questions. Allah Almighty has certainly bestowed a great reward for Sister Ferida in the hereafter, and for those who shed blood of innocent people, there is a punishment prepared on the Day of Judgment.
Ferida, jedan od gledalaca je napisao komentar da je Allah Dželešanu sigurno pripremio nagradu za tebe I za sve tvoje, a da je isto tako pripremio I kaznu na one koji su pobili ljude.
Amen. We received a comment from a sister doctor. My Bosnian friends are very genuine and put our activism to shame. They stand up for other individuals and groups. They recognize racism and call it out sometimes before victims realize it.
Jedna od sestara koja je gledala je isto tako rekla da poštuje svoje bošnjačke sestre koji su isto tako, koji su ne samo žrtve rasizma, već se I bore aktivno protiv rasizma I prepoznaju ga prije nego što ga iko drugi prepozna.
So there is one question. Did Middle East countries help Bosnia during the war?
I guess I, Dr. Zahid, you want to speak about it?
You should do that.
Not really. Surprisingly, many of the Middle Eastern countries actually supported the other side, supported actively Serbian regime, such as Saddam Hussein, such as Muammar Gaddafi, and some of other leaders of the Middle East. Some did help, like Saudi Arabia notably was the most active and most helpful to the Muslims of Bosnia. Malaysian government, later on even Turkish government joined and tried to help, and the Iranian government at that time. But the biggest help came from United States government, which try to stop the war and stop the killing, but it was unable to do so because the European allies were preventing United States to intervene. And eventually, United States government did step in and stop the bloodshed. And that was one of the examples of really what the United States can do when it takes that moral leadership that we all expect from the United States. But I think part of that story is also ICNA was involved in that. Dr. Zahid, do you want to say something about ICNA's involvement at that time?
Nahmadu Nusalli ala Rasooli al-Kareem. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, the stories with Sister Farida and Brother Kadir, they mention, I think it's difficult to stop our tears, although it's 25 years already passed. But I think the whole crisis, the Bosnia war and the genocide and killing and ethnic cleansing and Srebrenica genocide officially recognized, there are, I think, the couple of impact on the Muslim American Muslim community, and there are vice versa. There are some activism here. First of all, I think I will say very frankly that before this crisis, the war started in 1992 or whatever date, February 92 or something. Living in America for several years and doing my degrees and education and thinking that we know a lot about the Muslim world and other things, generally the American Muslim community was totally unaware that in the heart of Europe, there are so many Muslims, like Muslim majority areas, and Albania, the Muslim majority country, they were there. So absolutely no knowledge was there. With this war and when things started coming up in the media, and I think American media was very helpful during that period. I remember that Newsday, it is a newspaper from Long Island, and I used to live there during that period. Ray Gottman, I think that was the reporter, he first published the concentration camp in organized by the Serb. And first time those stories and those pictures were there in the American media as the Nazi concentration camp stories. I think the picture was, the similar pictures and stories came over there. So the first thing is that this education to the American Muslim community and American public, what is going on over there, and in the heart of Europe, Muslims are there, and Muslims are being severely victimized during that period. Number two, I think the lesson we learned that American Muslims become very much united and active on that issue. And with the help of partnership with other sectors of the society, for example, National Organization of Women or some other religious groups, they work so hard for the Bosnia cause in public advocacy here. Third, also that the American Muslim Relief Organization, I remember that during in 1992, ICNA established ICNA Relief. And they work so much. The executive director, Brother Tarukur Rahman, I think he visited 8 or 9 times that area and remained there for several months in each of his visit, and took the whole supply line, whatever meager, I think, the not-for-profit organization can do. But also, for example, receiving doctors from all over the world and making arrangement of receiving them or in the hospital and pharmacy and all those things. And I think American Muslim community was able to develop several relief organizations after that experience. And another also feature that American Muslim community feel that there was some success also when ultimately the Senate passed the resolution of the lifting embargo on the Bosnian side, because at that time, if you remember that, you know, definitely perfectly well, that there was an embargo and no arms could be delivered to the Bosnian Muslims. But the other side, they have everything, but the embargo was ultimately, it was lifted, but a lot of struggle happened during that period. And another lesson also we learned that when the Bosnian refugees coming in the United States, I think after the accord and something, I think a lot of masajid, mashallah, they become very active, and they try to host them, whatever help they can do. I understand there must be some issues, but I think that also happened. So what the ICNA initiated, I think the very beginning, in the summer of 1992, when those stories coming up, and the Rai Gatman was publishing story, and other newspaper were also publishing those pictures and stories, what is happening over there, that whatever our contact here in Bosnian Muslims and Kosovo Muslims, so we collectively with the ICNA initiated that with the Chicago Muslim community and all other national organizations, and form a Bosnia Task Force. And I think in the 3 or 4 years, it was so activism because no issues were there. Our masajid were involved, our national organizations were involved, our all group, sisters and youth, everybody was involved and making partnership with other. So they did, I think the three main thing happened, maybe 3 to 5 main thing happened. And I quickly like to say that. You would like to make a translation in between? Sorry, I'm just speaking there.
Well, it's too much. It's too long.
Yeah.
We can just...
I'm sorry. I should have stopped.
That what Dr. Zahid was emphasizing, Dr. Zahid is also a professor of political science. Among other universities, he was at Georgetown. He was talking about the fact that, you know, many Muslims in the United States...
In Bosnian language, English I already spoke.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. dakle, naš dr. Zahid je inače profesor isto političkih nauka u Americi i od fakulteta možemo da izdvojimo jedan na kojem je bio, na kojem je radio je Georgetown University. I on govori o tome kako šta je rat u Bosni i Hercegovini, kako je rat u Bosni i Hercegovini probudio muslimane u Americi. Jer prije toga ja sam govorio o tome da je možda najaktivniju ulogu u tom ratu I najkonstruktivniju ulogu u tom ratu odigrala upravo odigrale Sjedinjene Američke Države koje su se nakon srebreničkog genocida odlučile da samostalno intervenišu kako bi zaustavile rat. I dr. Zahid je govorio o tome kako je vrlo kako je taj rat u Bosni I Hercegovini I to što se događalo muslimanima u Bosni I Hercegovini probudio muslimane u Americi. Kaže, oni su došli ovdje, bili su relativno novi u ovoj zemlji I mislili su da sve, da oni dobro poznaju muslimanski svijet s obzirom da su došli iz muslimanskih zemalja. Međutim, odjednom su vidjeli da se događa rat u Bosni I Hercegovini I nakon novinskog članka koji je objavio Roy Gottman u Newsweeku, ili ja mislim da je bio Christian Science Monitor, objavio je fotografije logora u Prijedoru, u Keratermu I u Trnopolju, objavio je fotografije iz tih koncentracijnih logora I to je šokiralo čitavu američku javnost, a šokiralo I muslimane u Americi I oni su shvatili, tek tad su naučili da postoje dijelovi Evrope gdje su muslimani u većini, kao što je Bosna I Hercegovina, kao što su Albanija, I oni su se onda angažovali da pomognu muslimane Bosne I Hercegovine I potrudili su se na nekoliko načina. Prvo što su se trudili da pomognu putem humanitarne pomoći, pa putem medicinske pomoći, organizovali su ljekare koji su na neki način pomagali ranjenicima I žrtvama tog rata. Nekoliko muslimanskih organizacija je tada napravilo tu humanitarni most u smislu doturanja pomoći žrtvama I na kraju su se angažovali u političkom smislu, napravili su nešto što se zove Bosnian Task Force, gdje su lobirali da recimo američki senat ukine embargo na oružje za bosansku vojsku, jer bosansko-hercegovačka armija je imala problem da nije mogla da se naoruža, dok je druga strana, kao što svi znamo, imala manji problem jer su oni naslijedili oružje od bivše Jugoslovenske narodne armije. Tako da su se oni svi angažovali na tom planu I to je u mnogome probudilo muslimane Amerike da se okrenu aktivizmu, znači da rade, da koriste muslimanima I u Bosni, a I u svijetu.
Thank you. I will inshallah stop after a couple of sentences. The three major things I think we have done. One is that the big rally, the biggest rally at that time in Washington, D.C. for Bosnia, where all Muslim leaders came, and Brother Yusuf Islam especially came from Europe, and that was in front of the White House.
Znači, muslimani su radili tri velike aktivnosti apropo bosanskog rata, posebno u organizaciji ove organizacije ICNA, Islamic Circle of North America, znači islamski, kako bi rekli, krug Sjeverne Amerike, a oni su organizovali prvo što bi on istakao je napravili su velike demonstracije u Washingtonu, DC-u, znači u glavnom gradu Amerike, i za te demonstracije između ostalih je i došao brat Yusuf Islam iz Britanije, iz Engleske, da prisustvuje tim demonstracijama.
In Bosnia Task Force, Imam W.D. Muhammad, Imam Siraj Wahaj, Imam Jamil Al-Amin, or Afro-American Imam, and all other national organizations, ISNA, ICNA, Shura Council, everybody was there. And it's a true representation of the American Muslim community at that time.
The Malik, just a quick reminder that in case you think of something later on, we do have a WhatsApp group. I'll be talking about that in detail later. But please know that we have a WhatsApp for the general body. Exactly.
Okay, so I assume that means the questions could be posted on the WhatsApp too, right? Dr. Zahid je rekao da je taj Bosnian task force koji su oni organizovali bio zaista reprezentativan od svih muslimana u Americi. Vrlo značajni dio tog Bosnian task force su bili naša braća iz afroameričke muslimanske zajednice, uključujući Waredin Muhameda, koji vodi jednu od najvećih muslimanskih afroameričkih organizacija u Americi, uključujući Siraj Vehadža, koji je vrlo poznat daija u Americi, i uključujući imama Džamila, koji je vodio isto tako jednu veliku afroameričku muslimansku organizaciju u Americi. Pored njega su bili ICNA, ISNA i sve ostale organizacije dio tog Bosnian Force.
Then we have a big rally in September 95 in front of UN, where I remember the thousands of people were there. So the senator at that time from New York, it was an Italian-American Republican, Senator DiMatteo. So when he heard that the thousands of people are in front of UN and they are demanding the embargo should be lifted and the rape should be declared as a war crime, and those who are doing all this genocide and ethnic cleansing, they should be treated as war criminal. All the demands are going on. So he himself, he sent his staff. Then he himself came, although we could not contact him in before, but he himself came and made a very passionate speech during that demonstration rally when we were doing in front of UN.
And the treća stvar koju bi on htio da naznači je da smo da je ICNA organizovala 95. znači dok se Srebrenica događala, organizovali su najveće demonstracije koje su se desile ispred Ujedinjenih nacija. Ja moram priznati da sam ja bio dio tih demonstracija tada, da se tu sakupilo desetine hiljada ljudi i da su tražili da se digne embargo na oružje za bosansko-hercegovačku vojsku, da se silovanje tretira kao ratni zločin i da se oni koji ubijaju i koji siluju tretiraju kao ratni zločin. I to su bile toliko velike demonstracije da je tadašnji senator iz američke države New York, DiMaggio, koji je inače republikanac, kad je čuo za to da se toliko puno ljudi skupilo, umjesto da pošalje samo svoje predstavnike, sam je došao i održao vrlo snažan govor za sve te prisutne muslimane i druge ljude koji su se tu okupili i tražio, otprilike potvrdio to što su i muslimani tražili. I to je bio značajan moment. Ja se isto sjećam, to je bio jedan vrlo snažan moment gdje se ikupilo možda 15-20 hiljada muslimana koji su obavili namaz ispred Ujedinjenih nacija i onda svi zajedno zatražili te stvari. I bilo je jasno svima da se zločini više ne mogu nastaviti, a da se ništa ne radi.
Okay, hundreds of rallies happened in all over America in different cities during this more than three years struggle. But I think one very prime activity what we were able to do, that was the Muslim leadership delegation visiting UN and visiting the members of Security Council. And that was champion, boxing champion Muhammad Ali was also part of that delegation.
Bilo je puno demonstracija po čitavoj Americi, ali kaže jedna stvar koja je bila izuzetno bitna je da smo mi na kraju uspeli da se organizujemo, vođeni između ostalog sa legendom Muhammedom Alijem, a da obiđemo I razgovaramo sa svim članicama Savjeta bezbjednosti I da utičemo I na njih.
And I was in New York, so I was assigned the duty to organize this delegation to host them. And I remember that the way we were going to the different offices, the Security Council members, and the reception of that delegation, especially because Muhammad Ali was there, and issue was very genuine. And then when we had the press conference in the UN headquarters, the big hall was full. I think the press people, everybody from all over the world, they were there in that room. And when the statement was read, I think Imam Jamil al-Amin, it was prepared. And all those demands that it should be declared genocide, not only ethnic cleansing. Rather, initially, the demand was that it should be declared Holocaust. But then some of our own cousins and brothers, they suggested, no, it should not be repeated. The genocide, we should demand that. So instead of just ethnic cleansing, more than that, it should be declared not massacre, not ethnic cleansing, but should be declared genocide. Embargo should be lifted. Rape should be declared as war crime. And those who are doing all those war crimes, so they should be declared war criminals. And there should be they should be tried in the international criminal laws. So that was I remember vividly the way people in New York, they were receiving champion Muhammad Ali. Whenever he was standing, when we are coming out of one office, going to other, walking on the New York Manhattan Street, he was distributing literature on Islam and people was start gathering. So the reception in UN, in their offices, on the street, it was a unique experience which we got during that period.
Dr. Zahid isto podsjeća nas na to da su oni onda posle toga vođeni sa Muhammedom Alijem organizovali veliku konferenciju za štampu u Ujedinjenim nacijama I kaže I sjeća se kako je onaj hol Ujedinjenih nacija, to je velika dvorana, bio prepun novinara I gdje su oni ponovili svoje zahtjeve I posle toga su opet obišli individualne članove Savjeta bezbjednosti I ostale značajne članove Ujedinjenih nacija I svuda su bili vođeni od strane Muhameda Alija I svuda je taj, kako bi rekli, svuda su ih primili sa velikim uvažavanjem I poštovanjem. I think that's, we can maybe comment on some other questions.
Last comment I would like to make. No, I think that was the, to some extent, success story in American Muslim community, the whole community felt that pain what is happening over there, and they also felt that they can work in a unity and together, and they contacted Congress, they contacted the White House, and all those activities were done in the hope that, as I think some speaker was saying, that it should not happen, never again it should happen. But unfortunately, what is happening right now in Kashmir, in with Uyghur Muslims, in Rohingya, in Palestine, still those types of things are going on, and there is a very strong indicator that genocide could happen in Kashmir, or in genocide is happening in Rohingya and Palestine and Uyghur Muslims. So I think the American Muslim community or the world, I think the conscious that they should be alive, again, they should be feel some these type of feeling, and they should do collectively to stop those type of ongoing or what is the potential of genocide, which is happening again. And I think the biggest lesson we can learn from this Bosnia and Srebrenica genocide, that now the world should really work together to stop these potential genocide in Muslim in that part of the world, in South Asia and near that area, inshallah, and the Middle East, inshallah.
I za kraj dr. Zahid kaže da je ono što je bitno za da je bosanski rat naučio muslimane u Americi da mogu da rade zajedno, da se udruže i da kad se udruže mogu da učine dobro I da spriječe ili da utiču na to da se sprečava ubijanje nevinih ljudi. On kaže da je Kadir spomenuo, a i sestra Ferida su spomenuli kako oni ne bi htjeli da se ovo ikome ikada ponovi, ali kaže da smo svjedoci da se danas u svijetu slične stvari događaju muslimanima u Kini, u Uigurima, da se i slične stvari događaju muslimanima u Kašmiru, da se događaju muslimanima u Mjanmaru, znači, i da se eventualno događaju muslimanima u Palestini. I kaže, ako smo išto naučili iz tog iskustva sa genocidom u Srebrenici i Bosni, naučili smo da ako se ne suprotstavimo tome, da onda genocid će se ponoviti opet i opet i da moramo da učinimo sve što možemo, da probudimo savjest svijeta da zaustave ovi zločini koji se sada događaju i u ostalim dijelovima svijeta.
You can also include the Muslims and minorities in India also, because they are also facing that type of potential, that type of cleansing and something like that. They are also facing that.
A slične se stvari događaju i muslimanima u Indiji i ostalim dijelovima muslimanskog svijeta. Okay, but let's have, since we have opportunity to speak with Ferida and Kadir, if we have any more questions and comments for them. Brother Waqas.
Can I ask?
So there is one question. Sorry, Zahid, you wanted to say something.
No, you go ahead. Then I will.
One question, Dr. Murshid. 8,000 men and boys were killed, but what happened to sisters?
On kaže, pita vas šta se dogodilo ženama Srebrenice, našim sestrama, ako su muškarci i dječaci pobijeni.
Žene koje su bile u potočarima, jer sam ja bila tu u potočarima, znači kad su muškarce odvojili, znači od 10 godina pa do 80 muškarci su odvajale, a nas su žene u autobuse, kamione i prevezli u kladanj, odnosno u Tuzlu.
So the men and the boys aging from 10 to 80 were separated from women and children and taken, but women and children were put on the buses and trucks and taken to a free territory of Tuzla and other cities.
But we have to add that some of those buses never reached the destination.
Yes.
So they also murdered. In fact, the youngest and the oldest victims of the Srebrenica genocide were women. The youngest was a baby, just a few days old. Mm-hmm. And the oldest victim was, I believe, a woman of 88 years old. So primarily they targeted men, but the women were also killed. But Lena is from the Institute for the Research of Genocide, so she has even more details.
Yes, but women also, between whatever was happening inside the Potočari at that time, when the Serbs were taking over, the women were also raped. They were taken to the different houses and raped by Serbian soldiers. As you know, being raped in our culture and in our religion per se, not our religion, but it's mostly our cultures, is very shunned. Women get shunned, and it's a taboo. So it was very hard to continue talking about that and, you know, kind of tell somebody, hey, this is what happened to me. So it took a lot of work and a lot of effort from different organizations, Muslims and other organizations throughout the world, to actually give these women a voice to speak and say what happened to them. Go ahead.
In fact, I would tell the audience, there was no concept of war crime, of war crime before the Holocaust on Jews and Roma people in Europe in World War II. So only after World War II, these things were seen as war crimes, believe or not, right? And so what Bosnian War brought to the world, for the first time after Bosnian War, rape was recognized as a war crime. Many people don't know, but before that, rape was not seen as a war crime, and it was done throughout the world, not only in Bosnia, and unfortunately also was done in South Asia in during the separation between India and Pakistan, right? And then later on during the separation between Pakistan and Bangladesh. So it was not seen as a war crime. And the first time ever recognized as a war crime was actually after the Bosnian War, and in part due to these efforts that Dr. Zahid also talked about.
There's a question for Brother Kadir, if that's okay. So the question is for Brother Kadir as well as Sister Farida. Your resilience is inspiring. Where and how did you find strength to cope?
Sad pitanje za Kadira i za Feridu. Neko je postavio pitanje i rekao da je vaša snaga i vaša snaga da i dalje o tome pričate je zaista fascinantna. Gdje pronalazite tu snagu da i dalje živite sa tim što ste preživjeli i o tome govorite? Pa evo može Kadir, pa onda Sestra Ferida.
Da, ja sam u stvari veliki dužnik svih onih ljudi koji su zajedno bili na istom kamionu, a jedini sam ja ostao živ, onda je to normalno i razmišljati da sam ja dužan da pričam i govorim šta se tamo desilo tim ljudima. U stvari ja imam osjećaj da je i moj život završen zajedno sa njihovim. I ja sam dužan isto tako da upozoravam u svakoj mogućnosti. I ja se u stvari borim na jedan poseban način da pišem knjige i da govorim o tom.
Well, he says that he feels that he owes to these other men that were on that truck who were all murdered. There was all of them were murdered on that night, and he feels that he owes to them to continue to talk about them and to talk about the truth of what happens to them. He also feels that in some way he also died that night, but his life has some special meaning and purpose when he continues to talk about what happened, and this is why he is writing books and still talking about it. Sestro Ferida, možeš nam ti reći odakle tebi snage da sve to preživiš i da je to i dalje svjedočiš o tome?
Pa snagu nalazim prvenstveno u vjeri, jer sve je od Allaha, znači mi smo svi na Allahovim iskušenjima. I isto tako prepoznala sam potočarima i nepravdu i zlo. I kako odvajaju djecu malu i ubijaju, kako djevojke i žene odvode siluju. Tako isto vjera u Allaha mi daje snagu da idem dalje, i što mi je ostao u amanet sin od muža, da se radi njega borim i da istrajem na tom putu.
Well, sister said that she is finding a strength. Her strength comes from the deen, from Islam, and from the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She also witnessed how people were murdered, children and elderly, how women were taken away and raped while they were in Srebrenica. But she says also that the strength comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and she feels that she is in the same way responsible to convey the truth. She also added that, remember, she was 7 months pregnant when she separated from her husband. She gave a birth to a boy. He's, mashallah, now a big man, young man. She says, this is a son that was entrusted upon me. This is my amana. And because of him, I also have to speak about that and tell the world the truth.
Can I? There is one question, I think, Sister Lena, for Sister Lena also, that if she can describe her work what type of work she's doing and how can we get benefit from that.
Sure. So I work for the Institute for the Research of Genocide in Canada with Dr. Emir Ramic, who's the director of it. I'm a general secretary. What we do is actually we fight for the rights of the innocent victims of Bosnia and Herzegovina, but also other countries as well. Our major goal is, and what we do is trying to prove that the genocide did happen, which it did happen and it was proved. So now what we're trying is to have the whole world accept that, as well as the aggressors, the Serbians, accept that the genocide did happen so that we can move on. Unfortunately, that's not the case, and we are still fighting the enemies through our work, who are trying to stop us from spreading out the word and to let everybody know what happened in Srebrenica and Bosnia in general. I come from Prijedor, which is the second place that had ethnic cleansing done, and close to about 50 members of my family were killed, including my uncles and my other family members, which I still, exactly like Sister Ferida, don't know where the bones are, nevertheless where everybody else is. So it is our fight, and we continue to work through this institute that we closely work with the Bosnian government and other governments who are willing to help us out to find the aggressors, to take them to the international courts, and we have done a lot of work. So right now, our goal for this was to go to, for this year for Srebrenica Memorial, was to actually go to Srebrenica and attend the memorial. But unfortunately, it was part of my job, but unfortunately due to coronavirus, we're not able to. So what we did, one of the other projects that we had is contacting every province throughout Canada and trying to get the proclamation of the Remembrance Day, July 11th, proclaimed the Srebrenica Day. And we have done about eight of them in a few cities in Canada that proclaimed July 11th as the Srebrenica Memorial Day, as well as in Texas. We did in Dallas, Texas, and a few other cities. So we're really advocating for on behalf of the victims, basically. This is our job. This is what we're trying to prove, that Bosnians did go through the genocide and ethnic cleansing, and the ones who are responsible need to take the responsibility. And so we can continue, living in peace. Otherwise, there's not going to be peace till, the other side says, okay, we did it. It's wrong. We're sorry. Let's move on. But I don't think that will ever happen. Let's hope. Let's hope for the best, inshallah. Thank you.
They have a website, and you can probably, if you Google Institute for the Research of Genocide with the Canada extension, I think they have a website, so you can find it. But I think we'll also, on July 18th, we will talk more about these political implications behind it.
Yeah, and you are more than welcome to contact me directly and ask any questions, informations. I'm more than happy to provide you with. Thank you.
We have a question in both Bosnian and English from Sanja Mehremic. I was wondering what suggestions can be given for the younger generations to be a part of meetings such as this and remembering Srebrenica. So this is an open question you can assign to someone.
But I believe let's ask Sister Ferida, because she's the mother, and then maybe Sister Lena can speak about it. I have five children. I can talk about my kind of approach. But Sestra Ferida, jedna od naših sestara koja gleda ovaj program, je pitala kako bi trebali ili kako da ubijedimo svoje mlade, svoju djecu, da gledaju recimo ovakav program. Da ih zanima da gledaju ovakav program. Šta bi ti kao majka predložila ili preporučila roditeljima koji gledaju kako da pristupe svoje djeci i da im objasne zašto i kako trebaju ovo gledati?
Vidite, moj cilj, znači, od drugi razred srednje škole je bio kad je ukopao svog oca, znači, od tada, a i od prije je dvije godine počeo ići na dženazu i on ne propušta, znači Ramazan kad se postilo, I kad je bila temperatura I sve, on nije mrsio, znači on je postio, a išao je na dženazu. Danas, pored svih ovih mjera, zbog ovakve situacije u svijetu, on je opet išao danas u potečare. Znači, to sve opet je do roditelja. Da pričamo, da govorimo šta se desilo da bi to ušlo nekako I doprlo do njihove svijesti, do, da bi mogli to da shvate da je to bilo nekad nešto.
Sister said that her own son, he buried his father when he was in high school. He did not know, they couldn't find his remains, and then after that they identify him, they bury him in his when he was in high school. But he was nevertheless going every year for these janazas to Srebrenica, and ever since then he was going to Srebrenica for janaza. Even when he would fast, he would go and be there. And it is important for him to remember. And as far as I can say to my Bosnian brothers and sisters throughout the world, I will remind you, I am a father of five children too. And every July I sit with all my five children at home and we watch a documentary. I will recommend Christ and the Grace. So I sit with my children in July and I watch a documentary, is a good documentary, Cry from the Grave. It is available online, not on YouTube, but on some other channels. And I sit with them and we watch and we talk about it. We talk about it. I insist that we do. We talk about what we saw, what was the lessons that we can learn. And this is very important. I will remind all of you that our Jewish friends, they talk about Holocaust throughout the world and throughout all the time to their children, to their youth, to everybody, and remind people about what happened there. Why is that happen? Why that happened and what happened? That's important for stability of their mind and for their stability of their identity. They need to know why the world is the way it is for them today. So if you speak to them about it, they will know. If you don't speak to them about it, they will form their own opinion, and maybe that opinion will not be the best one. Why? Because they may be missing information. So if you don't mind, I will just answer in Bosnian briefly. Vrlo je važno da se sa svojom djecom o tome razgovara. Ja sam otac petero djece I ono što ja uradim svakog jula, ja sjednem sa svojom djecom I pogledam neki dokumentarni prilog o Srebrenici, o tome šta se tamo desilo I porazgovaram sa njim, kažem im šta je bilo, porazgovaramo o tome šta smo vidjeli I napravimo neki zaključak. Razumite da je to vrlo važno da se radi, to je posao roditelja, da se djeci pomogne da shvate zašto su, na primjer, ako žive u Americi, u Srpskoj, gdje god, zašto su tu ili šta se desilo njihovim roditeljima. To njima pomaže da se izgrade bolje kao ljudi. Znači, ja znam da često ljudi imaju potrebu da na neki način zaštite svoju djecu. Međutim, vrlo je važno da djeca znaju zašto im se to desilo. I ja sam podsjetio sve da, na primjer, naši... da jevreji pričaju o tome šta se njima desilo u toku holokosta u Drugom svjetskom ratu, podsjećaju sve I svoju djecu I svoju omladinu zato što je važno njima da znaju kroz šta su prošli I da znaju I da razumiju šta im se desilo. Jer ako vi to sa njima ne budete razgovarali, oni će svakako formirati mišljenje koje možda neće biti ispravno I dobro zato što možda neće imati dobre informacije. Prema tome, vrlo je važno da se o tome razgovara I ne treba se bojati, jer mladi ljudi imaju I načina I potrebe da shvate zašto su tu gdje jesu.
Ako mogu ja još samo da dodam, if I may, please.
Sure. Yes, please.
So, try Srebrenica and other ethnic cleanse, Srebrenica is a genocide that has happened in Bosnia. And basically, you touched the ground, but I just want to say that it's very important to keep that, you know, remembrance of culture within our youth. Srebrenica genocide and Prijedor ethnic cleansing in other cities throughout Bosnia is a history, something that we have to live with, learn, and carry it on so that it's never forgotten. Otherwise, this will repeat. This is the 11th genocide that has been done against our Bosniak nation in Bosnia and throughout the Balkanian countries. So we really have to pay attention to this. And this is why I do my work and everybody else who's involved. We're trying to educate the world and Bosnians and Bosniak nation to what is going on within the world, what happened to us, so that it will not be repeated. Thank you.
Okay, inshallah. I think next, as Dr. Mirsad said it before, next Saturday on 18th at 3 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, we will have another webinar, inshallah. So inshallah. I hope that there's more and more people will be joining that, inshallah.
We have a link, icna.org/Bosnia, that also has the other video that Dr. Mirsad mentioned, The Cry from the Grave, and it has a lot of other resources, research by Dr. Mirsad, and it has the official statement of ICNA on this matter. I request you to visit that page. Inshallah, we are going to add more resources, videos, statements, pictures, and so on. Again, the website is icna.org/Bosnia. I'm going to put it on the screen. Just give me a moment. Yeah, right there. So right now it's on the screen as well. And inshallah, stay in touch. It also has the information of the webinar that Dr. Zahid mentioned next week by ICNA Council for Social Justice. On a similar topic, while we are still commemorating, and there could be more events that we may come up with in the next 2 weeks until July 22nd, that this commemoration continues, inshallah. So please stay in touch, and on behalf of Islamic Circle of North America, on behalf of our guests, our respected guests, our speakers, Sister Ferida, Brother Kadir, Sister Lena, Dr. Zahid, and most importantly, Dr. Mirsad, thank you for your cooperation, your research, and your support. Inshallah, we look forward to your continued cooperation. Jazakallahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Wa alaikum assalam.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اشهد ان لا اله الا الله استغفرك واتوب اليك